We're going back in time, ladies and gentlemen. That's right, I just bought out the remaining inventory of XPC, a long dead PC store that hasn't even had a website for the last 8 years. So all of this stuff in here has been sitting around collecting dust in a warehouse for nearly a decade. Probably longer, judging on the state of some of the packaging. Do you want to dig through it with me? Do you want me to tell you about our sponsor? Thanks to Pulseway for sponsoring this video. Pulseway is an all-in-one platform management tool that can help protect your business from things like phishing and ransomware. Try for free today at the link in the video description. There's four boxes?
Yeah, this whole skid is all stuff.
Oh, so we actually bought the entire,
yes,
like, remaining stock.
Uh-huh.
This is a GPU water cooler, but it's unlike anything you would find on the market today. Oh, this is gonna be fun. You knew some of the wildest stuff had to be from Thermaltake, right? Like, what do these guys not make? Oh my gosh. Remember laptop expansion cards, ladies and gentlemen? You could add a whopping 4 USB 2 ports to your laptop. Nicole actually still has a laptop that takes card drives. Whoa, this one's got USB 2 and FireWire. You wanna ingest some footage, Mark?
Oh, yeah.
At real-time speed? What is this pill? This is a pill from Buffalo. You know the external hard drive, guys? Okay, I must know what the pill is. $9.50. This is the medicine that your keyboard needs. It's got a twist top. Fetch me a laptop. Ah, yes. Now for a product demonstration. Yeah, I don't think I'd pay $9.50 for this. I gotta do this thing. Thermaltake. For the price of just $14.99, you could get the Cyclo Cooling Memo. Cyclone cooling for memory. Oh man. Let me show you guys how we cooled our memory 2000 style. These look like LED fans. I bet you $100 that they're blue. They're so weak. Yeah, the RGB memory under it makes these little pinner LEDs look super unimpressive. Surprisingly quiet for having been sitting for over a decade. Ooh, these guys, I never understood it. As an enthusiast, I was like, why do they exist? Why do you get to charge $12 for the world's most basic 80 millimeter fan? Even back then, did I say 80? I meant 70. And that's the answer. Because StarTech has one of basically everything. Hold on a second. I recognize this packaging. This was exactly the same color scheme and packaging that NCIX used for its house brand Engear products. These were the shiz though. Taking your floppy drive, cause like, who needed one of those, and turning it into a card reader. Get that SD, MMC, compact flash, smart media, memory stick. Man, do you guys remember when Sony had so much proprietary bullcrap? Me too, because it was yesterday. And also 20 years ago. Wen Tang. Series USB port equipment, plug and play. What even is it? A USB to parallel cable, so you can plug in your old printer.
Oh, I legitimately might need that for my lathe.
You need this?
Yeah.
Take it. Removable FRAM for 3.5-inch and 2.5-inch HDD. This is before my time. Holy crap! You would use a 5.25-inch bay. So that's your optical drive bay. You'd plug this chungus bad boy into it. I mean, that's why we had full towers that were this freaking big. Boy, have we ever come a long way on these. Got your USB-C 2.5-inch drives, got these little tiny mobile SSDs. You just off to the races. But no, this is technology. But at least you had security. You know, you got the lock on the front. Okay, now we're getting into the real good stuff. Zalman has tried just about everything, I think. And this is their 5.1 channel headphone amplifier. Colin, how much you wanna bet that this still works?
20 bucks.
20 bucks. Okay, that's too much. Too rich for my blood. Hold on a second. This thing is crazy. What? No, Colin, it is not in fact USB.
It's RCA.
volume control interface between 5.1 channel headphones. You can plug two users into it. So you got your front, rear, and center slash subwoofer channels for both. Separate volume knobs. Who would have bought this? And then you've got whatever your source is. Front left, front right. You know what, Colin? I was wrong. This would totally work. Not that you'd want to, because it's really, really stupid. Thanks, digital surround. Look at this flow meter. You wanna know how fast your water's going? What about this? It stinks. That's weird. Bye. TV capture. I remember TV tuner cards. I really wish that this had been more of a thing. It was because of resistance from the cable cos. You guys know that, right? They wanted you to sit and watch the freaking ads. Ah, these were fun. Okay, so we've got both an ATI silencer and an NV silencer for. And as you guys can probably guess, these were for ATI and NVIDIA cards respectively. And these were freaking awesome. Arctic Cooling, man. They were the shiz back in the day. And this is not nearly old enough, Colin, if this was your intention. Most graphics card back in the day were single slot and they would have these wimpy little coolers. In fact, in a lot of cases, they wouldn't even be configured like this one where they're blowing air toward the back of the case. They would just be sitting on the card right here, chilling, just blowing air around into your computer case. And what that obviously affected was your CPU temps, your motherboard temps, everything else. Because even back then, your GPU was one of the hottest running components in the system. Arctic Cooling allowed you to put what is actually, by modern standards, a pretty decent looking cooler on your GPU after the fact that had multiple benefits. Better performance, quieter, and they had the added benefit of kicking all the heat out of your system. So check this out. You got your copper cold plate, you've got cooling for your memory chips, then you had your cooler. This guy right here would go like this, blowing air through these fins, and then you can see it's actually kind of ducted here in its shape. So you'd have your stock PCI cover right here, and then they would give you a second vented one to install next to it, effectively turning your GPU into a modern style dual slot card. So it would expel all the heat from your case through the back IO panel, and then, this is the best part, check this out. Okay, we've seen coolers for the backs of graphics cards. In fact, a lot of coolers come with a backplate these days. Even this one comes with a backplate. But this was back when they cared about freaking cooling on the backplate. Your card would be this thick. Oh no! I love this. This is amazing. I remember these. Jake, you wanna make the server go faster, boys? You gotta put one of these on your hard drive.
Oh, I know what that is.
Actually, oh, can I have one of the new server ones? Thanks, Jake. I can't promise I won't put thermal paste on it. It actually served multiple purposes. These things were kind of cool if you had like a 10,000 RPM WD Raptor drive or something like that. Basically, you pop off the top and then you can see the inside is both heat-synced and yet insulated. Why would that be, you might ask? They served two purposes. One was anti-vibration. So the only drives that needed a cooling enclosure like this were ones that spun at higher RPMs, high performance drives, and they tended to vibrate more. So you've got this thick foam padding right here that theoretically will make it vibrate less, I guess. Oh my gosh, this thing feels so chungus in here. It totally doesn't fit. And you know what? Maybe I have the drive in upside down. Hold on, hold on. Yeah, IDE interfaces were at the bottom. Oh my God, it still works. Tell me this doesn't feel like performance hard drive. You can't.
It feels terrible.
Shut up, it does not. I want a second opinion. Colin, come touch my hard drive. All right, let's toss it in the pot. Just kidding, just kidding, just kidding, just kidding. Should have seen the look on Jake's face. Here you go. Oh, I forgot about this one. Oh my gosh, okay. So this is Thermal Take, doing what Thermal Take does best. Ripping off someone else's product. So you can see it's basically that Arctic Cooling cooler, right? Except Thermal Take added their own Bizarro Land spin to it and added water cooling to it. So it actually does both. It's like a hybrid air slash water cooler. And there were a handful of these back in the day. I actually reviewed one back when I was ghostwriting for Hardware Canucks. You managed to bring me every 8800 card except the one that this fits. This only goes on the GTX.
I tried.
It's okay, it's okay. These coolers were actually kind of neat because they used air cooling for your memory and your VRMs and all that good stuff. And then they used water for the GPU itself. Do we have a screwdriver? Do I have an iFixit kit handy? The main benefit of this approach is that it allowed you to focus all of your radiator power, right? So all of your cooling capacity on the GPU, which was what really mattered for overclocking. And it kept all of this heat from your DRAM and your VRMs and all that good stuff out of your water. So you could just dump that out of the system with air cooling and then use all of your radiator capacity to get the lowest possible temps on your GPU. The only issue with that theory is that you bought a thermal take water block. So let's go ahead and open this up and we're gonna find what I'm expecting to be a very rudimentary block design. Holy sh**, is this just sealed? We would have to cut it open. What were these screws even? Oh, they attached it to the heatsink. How hard is it for us to cut open a copper thing like this? Just saw it in half.
The bandsaw is pretty dead right now.
The bandsaw's dead? Can we throw it in the mill and just...
Sure.
Awesome, thanks Colin. While Colin's working on getting us a look at that thermal take block, I wanna show you guys something really special. This is not actually from XPC. This is from
Ion the Electrician.
He dug it up somewhere, I have no idea. If CPU fan stops working, CPU may become too hot. New CPU fan must be installed. If CPU fan is not working, look, the red light is on. But listen, the alarm is heard. The green light is on when CPU guard is on duty. You guys ready for this? Whoa, this thing is older than I thought. I thought the PCB was black, which would be an indicator of the age. Not only is it green, it's this kind of green. And as far as I can tell, this board was manually assembled. It was quite common for Molex-powered peripherals to have a Y-splitter in the package. And the idea was that a lot of power supplies didn't have extra Molex connectors. So if you wanted to plug in your CPU guard, oh, it's a little crusty. You'd need another cable coming off of it so that you could plug in your optical drive or whatever else it was that was plugged into it originally. The green light is on when CPU guard is on duty. Uh-huh. The system just shut down. All I did was power this board. Am I gonna... Oh my God, this is not turning on. I don't know if we're gonna be taking another crack at CPU guard. I was so excited to hear it. Look at the size of the speaker on it. Like, this thing was gonna freaking go. Oh, you know what? I think there's a manufacturing defect. There's a ball of solder in between these pins here. Hold on. I bet if I pick that out, it'll work. It works! Okay, it's really annoying. One moment, please. Okay, I need a crappy fan to absolutely destroy. Wire strippers and a sacrificial Molex. Stay in there, this is such a cheap housing. It just falls right out. Okay, where's that damn Zalman fan then? Oh yeah, oh yeah. Okay, you guys ready? It's sparking. It was completely not grounded in any way, even though there's a ground pin running right through it to the power supply. How is that even possible? Okay, look, I'm not saying the CPU guard is the best product in the world. I'm just saying that when your CPU fan stops, red light CPU fan is not working. Oh, it works, I love it, it's sort of. The last thing I wanted to look at, the inside of this Thermaltake water block. Yes, my friends, that is basically a heatsink style, like Northbridge heatsink style of fin construction, this would be so restrictive because your flow comes in the side and then they don't even have like a channel at the back, like an open channel at the back for it to flow through and come out the other one. It's not just cheap, it's stupid. How could you possibly design something this bad? Is there a flow through like that I'm not seeing here? There isn't. There's no path for the water to make its way to the other side. This is just a solid wall of fin. It would stop your water flow dead, basically. Oh, you know what? It's probably the domed top.
Yeah, there's definitely an air gap.
Yeah, but there were barely any places for the water to come out into the thing.
And that's why it had bad reviews.
Yeah, hey, reviews, the system works. Hey, sponsors, the system works for that too. This video is brought to you by... Thanks Squarespace for sponsoring this video. We use Squarespace, like no joke, we use it. Both our LinusMediaGroup.com and LTXExpo.com websites were built quickly using Squarespace and are easily maintained if we need to make any quick changes, like say, canceling our expo for 2 years in a row. If you haven't heard already, Squarespace is an all-in-one platform that makes it simple to get your website up and running quickly. If you have a home business, you definitely need one. You can even sell things. You can choose from tons of different templates and find the one that makes the most sense for you and then just run with it. And if you trip while you're running, you need help, Squarespace offers webinars, a full series of help guides, or you can contact their 24/7 support team to help you build your site. So go to squarespace.com/LTT and get 10% off today. Thanks so much for following along in this archaeological exploration of tech. If you guys want to see more like this, why not check out my attic exploration video where I unearthed some long forgotten history from the early days of Linus Media Group. And there's some fun tech in there as well.